body.
Because the church is not a building.
It never has been.
It never has been.
We gather today as one church.
One church.
To lift up one name.
The name of Jesus.
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 So wherever you are,
today is the day the Lord has made.
Today is the day we give him thanks.
So let's unite. Let's worship.
Let's praise his name.
For he is worthy of it today
and every day. Because we are still the church.
We are the church.
We are the church.
We are the church.
We are the church.
Good morning and welcome. Let us begin our service this morning with songs of praise. We're going to start out with number 218. That's why we praise him.
He came to live a perfect life. He came to be the living word, our life. He came to die, so we'd be reconciled. He came to rise, to show his power and light. That's why we praise him, that's why we sing, that's why we offer him our everything. That's why we bow down and worship this King, 'cause he came. He came to live again in us. He came to be the conquering King, our friend. He came to heal and show the lost ones his love. He came to go, prepare a place for us. That's why we praise him, that's why we sing, that's why. Sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore.
we just thank you for the opportunity to come into your house. We offer up our praise and our worship to you, Lord. Lord, we just ask that you would guide us and lead us in your way, not just today through this service, but throughout our week and through everything that we do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
But we came back to a particular fork in the road, really the only one that at that point was absolutely unrecognizable. I asked my son to pray about which road to take, and he felt strongly that we should go to the right, and I did as well. We went to the right, and it was a dead end. We went 400 or 500 or 600 yards, and it was an absolute dead end, clearly the wrong road.
Video, because it is a visual reminder that we're all on a path, and at times that path divides. The thing that stands out to me about the video I just saw is that being on the wrong road, he had the good sense to back up and take the right road. It's good to see all of you here this morning. Here on the front row, some of my relatives, and I know you'll welcome them, and it's good to have them here today. Many of you were in prayer for the Wright family this week. Richard passed away, and Diane is grieving. I know you'll continue to keep them in your thoughts and prayers. I saw her yesterday afternoon, and she was grateful for her church family. The plans are still in the air. We don't know what is going to happen in terms of a memorial service, but we'll know sometime in the future. In the meantime, your kindness and your thoughts, you know, they make a lot of difference when almost nothing else can. Let's bow together for prayer. Heavenly Father, we don't fully understand prayer. We come with a measure of faith, trusting that when we bow before you, you hear us and that your Son has made a way for us to share the deep needs of our hearts in the first place, and for that we're grateful. It would be good to begin with a sense of praise for the salvation you provided, and to remember that we're here because of Calvary. We're here because a long time ago, the God of the universe became flesh and blood and paid the penalty, the price for our sin. And by his wounds, by his stripes, we are healed. Help us never, Lord, to forget that or to get over that. Help us not so to discount our own sin that we stop appreciating the cost that was involved for us to be saved. Draw us back, Lord, to also be aware that you called us for a purpose. We're not here simply to wander around the earth or to make the best of each day, but that you have a purpose and your people are called to that purpose, that the whole world might know the healing, the forgiveness, and the life everlasting that is found nowhere else but your Son. Remind us of that today and why we're here to worship. We thank you, Lord, for your word, for the word that isn't any old word, but the word of God. And that somehow in the written word, in the pages of the Bible, your eternal word speaks to us, and the reality of Jesus, who is the word, comes to meet us face to face. With all of the false words that we hear every day, for a few minutes this morning, help us to hear the one word that gives life. Some of us are inclined to spend so much time at the complaint counter, registering the things we don't like and the problems that accumulate that we didn't deserve. We need to move over to the blessing counter and remember again how much you've done for us and how much we can do in Christ. All of us would benefit by being kinder, more patient, more loving, less prideful. We struggle, Lord, with our own flesh every day. We struggle with the limitations of our own wisdom every day. We fight against trusting our own inclinations rather than you every day. Make us instruments of your love, vessels of your grace, by allowing your Spirit today to have a greater hold on our own hearts and minds. And so I pray in Jesus' name. That was just beautiful. You ought to get your big old bus and hit the road, I'll tell you that. Really sweet, thank you. Several weeks ago, we began talking about a biblical principle. It is captured in the word the way, or the path, or the road. It is a principle that governs every aspect of life. The principle is this: your direction, not your intentions, determines your destination. That's, by the way, one of the reasons that you could get to this church this morning. Roads lead to the same place every time. I mean, wouldn't it be odd if, because I'm guessing you follow the same route to get here every time you do. And wouldn't it be odd if one Sunday it led here and the next Sunday it led to, I don't know, Martinsville? And you're like, how did I end up here? But it doesn't. The fact that you're here is a testimony to the principle that roads lead to the same place every time. And by the way, the direction that you're traveling, whether it's spiritual or financial or relational or maritally, also lead to the same place every time. This is a principle that's operating in the background of your life, whether you are aware of it or not, and whether you accept it or not. It doesn't really matter. It doesn't really change anything if you don't believe it. It's still operating in the background of our lives all the time. Your direction determines your destination. Now, I'd like for you to look at one little short proverb. It's actually there several times. It's in Proverbs 22. It's also in Proverbs 27. Would you look at it with me? It's a very short word of wisdom that is just packed with truth. And it underscores the principle that we've been looking at for several weeks. Here's how it goes. The prudent see danger and take refuge. But the simple just keep going and pay the price. The prudent see danger and take refuge. The simple or the naive just keep going and pay the penalty. Last week I asked you to think about whether there were any disconnects in your life between what you intend or what you want and the actual direction that you're going. Now, here is a husband who wants to have a strong marriage, a really vibrant, loving relationship with his wife. That's his intention. But he spends all of his time at work, and he rarely has any energy to listen to her. That's his direction. A college student wants to graduate with honors and set himself or herself up for getting a really good job. That's his intention. But he spends his nights fooling around in a fraternity house and partying on weekends. That's his direction. A wife wants to exercise and drop 2 dress sizes. That's her intention. But she spends her lunches with friends at a donut shop. That's her direction. And direction always trumps intention. Think of it this way. What if you could go back in time and talk with yourself at 17? Now, some of you just slap that person right in the face. Or would you listen to me? What were you thinking? If you could do that, what kind of advice would you give yourself? What if you could warn yourself of things that were going to cross your path in your 20s or 30s or even 40s? I mean, wouldn't life be so much easier if you could do it the second time around? And if you knew then what you know now? But that's not how life works. We only get to go around once in this life, and we don't get to do it a second time to get it right. When you get lost driving, you know, you may waste an hour or two. But when you get lost in life, man, you can waste years. You can waste a whole season of life. Nobody wants to wake up in their 50s and wish that they'd taken a different path in their 20s. And yet, I mean, we're all on a financial path. Question is it the one you want to be on? We're all on a spiritual path. We're all on a moral path. And each path has a destination. Are you on the path that you want to be on? Because direction, not intentions, always determines our destination. That's the powerful biblical principle I'd like for us to just live with for a few weeks. Now, last week I asked her, is there a discrepancy between things you intend and the direction your life is taking? This morning I want to ask you a different question. Are there warning signs in your life that you ought to be paying attention to? Haven't you had those conversations with someone who is telling you how messed up something is in their lives? Some kind of mess they've gotten themselves in. Maybe it's their credit card, or maybe it's a wrong career choice, or maybe they moved in with someone they should have moved out of, or they had this shoddy relationship with a dealership that was going to save them a bunch of money, and it turned out disastrous, or whatever it was. And as they're telling you the story, you're thinking to yourself, didn't you see this coming? Because it's clear to you. I mean, as they should, that's the dumb, don't you know? Couldn't you see? You remember the story of the woman at the well with Jesus? Now, I've had that woman come to me for counseling. And we don't know all the details, but I can tell you this. She had five husbands. And the man she was living with was not her husband. And I'm thinking to myself, if this woman were talking to me, I'd say, you were, how many times? Five? Is it possible that there's something going on in your life you're not looking at? How could you make mistakes five times? We ask those kind of questions, I would say about 90% of the time there were red flags. There were some hesitations. There were some early warning signs that were ignored. And the person just thought, well, somehow everything's going to work out okay. I don't understand it. I'm not sure. But somehow it's going to work out all right. And in a sense, that's true. Every decision does have an outcome. Every road does have a destination. Eventually it's going to work out, but not all destinations are good, which is why people end up in places they never wanted to be. And so they're exactly where they don't want to be, but exactly where the road that they took led them. Now, they're living in a place where life is hard, expensive, painful, and it didn't have to be that way because there were warning signs that were obvious, but they were oblivious to the obvious. Now, I want you to think back to that proverb I just read. Because Proverbs 27, verse 12, has the potential for helping all of us with all of life's complications. The wise, the prudent see danger and take a refuge. The simple see it, but they just keep going. Notice in this proverb that we're introduced to two kind of people, wise and simple. Now, the word simple can also mean naive, without experience. A cruder way of putting it is stupid. Wise and the simple. And they're both headed down the same path. Okay? And they both see the same danger. The way the proverb is set up, you got two people on the same road going the same direction, and they see the same danger. But they experience very different outcomes. Why? Because the prudent sees the danger and takes refuge. The wise person understands that life is connected. What we do is not isolated, it's connected to a path. And every path leads somewhere. And what we choose today, we're going to experience tomorrow. Wise people look down the road as far as they can and ask themselves the question, in light of my future hopes and dreams, in light of my current circumstances, in light of what I know about myself and my past, what's the wise thing to do? And the proverb says the wise person sees the danger and takes refuge. Now, in the second half of the proverb, we're introduced to the other guy. The simple just keep on going. Every time you do something that leads you away from Jesus, you're in that category. Every time you eat something you know you're going to regret, you fall into that category. Every time you talk yourself out of exercising, every time you light up a cigarette, every time you lie to your spouse, every time you spend money you don't have, you act as if today has no connection with tomorrow, and you put yourself in the category of that second group. The simple just keep on going. Now, the difference in these two people is not in what they see. They both see the same thing. It's in how they respond. But you already knew that.
You know, people who see danger, crap, man, they do something about it. And you know, people who see danger and they just keep on going. The wise person will identify unhealthy, sinful behaviors before they turn into habits. And they do something while they can. Look, there is a point in life of no return. There is a point when after you cross that line, it's like you can't avoid the consequences of the road that you're on. When the wise person sees a relationship moving in an unhealthy direction, they do something. The naive or the simple just keep on going. Now, I want you to notice one last thing. What does the last verse say? The simple keep on going and what? They suffer for it. They pay the price. They suffer for what? Well, for acting like the kids won't notice. For being oblivious to the obvious. For living as if there's no connection between what we do today and what's going to experience tomorrow. For overlooking the fact that every road has a destination. Like it or not, our decisions have consequences, both good and bad. And whether it's your marriage or your spiritual health or your finances or the way you discipline your kids or your relationship patterns or your moral behavior or your physical health, if you ignore that principle, there will come a time when all of your options are bad ones. When your credit cards are full and you're afraid to check your answering machine, that's not the time to consider a budget and altering your spending habits. When your spouse serves you with divorce papers, it's not the time to decide you want to work on your marriage. When the pregnancy test turns positive, it's not the time to reevaluate the soundness of your moral compass and whether he's really the right guy. There's a point at which we go past and the consequences are going. So what do? The proverb says the wise person sees a danger and they take refuge. That's another way of saying they do something about it. Get up and do something about it. It's not what you intend. And it's not what you see. It's a what you do. Seeing danger is only helpful if you do something about it. I mean, every Sunday, there are plenty of people that come into a sanctuary like this and hear the word of God, and they'll leave agreeing with everything they heard. And then they'll walk out of church, pick up exactly where they left, on a road that's leading them nowhere, and keep on going, ignoring everything they heard. I don't take it personally. We've all done it. We've all listened and agreed and felt convicted and then taken no action. The church is dying, by the way, today in this country by virtue of lots of people who get convicted and never take any action, keep on down the road, until the church is empty. Maybe it means making a phone call and having an awkward conversation. Maybe it means cutting up credit cards. Maybe it means breaking up or moving out or finding a new circle of friends. Maybe it means setting the alarm clock on Sunday morning. Maybe it means emptying the liquor cabinet or canceling HBO or joining a 12-step program.
Maybe it means scheduling the vacation you didn't get around to doing for too long. Maybe it means making an appointment with a competent counselor. Maybe it means selling the house. Maybe it means changing jobs. All of which are things that some of the people who have invited me into their lives have done as a way of seeing the danger and doing something about it. You say, that sounds extreme. Well, maybe so. But I can tell you this, I know people who would have done any of the things I just mentioned and more gladly to rewind their lives and avoid the circumstances that they're going through right now. There are all kinds of things that would seem extreme to other people that wise, godly people will do when they see danger and take refuge. And what feels like a sacrifice now turns out to be an investment later to get where we all want to be. Let me leave you with a prayer that you can use. And then go out of here and say that prayer so you don't end up where you don't want to be. Lord, here it is. Help us to see the trouble coming before it gets here. And give us the wisdom to know what to do and the courage to do it. Lord, help us see the trouble coming before it gets here. Give us the wisdom to know what you would have us do. And give us the courage to do it. Heavenly Father, remind us again that the wise see danger and take refuge. The simple just keep on going and pay the price. For all of us who long and desire to be godly, for all of us who struggle daily to be more like you, Lord, embed this parable in our hearts so that what we do today would bear fruit tomorrow. And no matter where we are now, put us on a path that will take us where we want to be. I pray in Jesus' name, amen. You know, this coronavirus has made various parts of doing church more difficult. Normally, I would be at the front and offer an invitation, first of all, for those who have never been saved, and then for those who God is speaking to. And we can't really do that today. I look forward to a time when we can. God's people are a confessing people. God's people are those who get touched by His Word. Let me do this. While we sing this closing hymn, you may have a prayer in your heart. And either where you are, or maybe on these steps, you'd want to come and just ask God for His strength. Let's stand together as we sing. Heavenly Father, as we leave this place today, help us to remember that it is out of your goodness we were ever born into this world. And it is out of your grace that we have been held and kept moment by moment right up until this very hour. And that it is out of your great love, a love that we've seen so clearly in the face of Jesus, that we are being redeemed. In his name, I pray. Amen. God bless you all. Have a great week.